Victorian Age, the time when the sun never set on the British Empire, the time when the Victorian upper classes felt that their society was the epitome of prosperity, progress, and virtue. This is the Albert Memorial. It's often been described as a monument to Victorian excess. Prince Albert, the husband of Queen Victoria, died in 1861, and Queen Victoria mourned his death, wearing black and retiring from public, until her death in 1901. She had a number of memorial monuments erected in his memory, including this one, and across the street, the Royal Albert Concert Hall. Albert was a great advocate of Victorian progress in science and in industry, and he planned the Great Exhibition of 1851. It was sort of a big world's fair that he planned to have here in Hyde Park, and he had the Crystal Palace constructed. It was a great glass building made out of glass and iron, and inside there were exhibitions from all the different countries that made up the British Empire, and there were exhibitions from the manufacturers, from the new technologies, from just about everything, the same type of thing that you might expect to find at a World's Fair today. Different parts of this Albert Memorial represent the different continents of the British Empire. The figures around the base represent different inventors, scientists, all of the great thinkers of ages past that Albert felt culminated in his Victorian age. This part of the statue represents Europe. As you can tell from the buffalo, this statue represents the Americas. This statue represents Africa.
This fourth statue represents Asia.
The figures on the frieze represent the great painters, poets, scientists, and inventors through the ages that contributed to the culmination of Victorian prosperity. And of course, in the center is the gilded figure of Albert himself. While this picture of a perfect civilization is one view of the Victorian era, writers revealed another side, a society in which scientific advances sometimes seem to conflict with the traditional religious beliefs we see in Hardy and in Arnold's Dover Beach, a society in which pride in their culture and a sense of obligation to spread that culture resulted in the imperialism we read about in Hardy and Conrad, a society in which technological advances meant prosperity for some and harsh poverty for others, as we see in Dickens' novels and in Barrett Browning's The Cry of the Children, a society very much like our own.